Good afternoon, everybody. I hope everybody's having a good afternoon. I scheduled this for 12:32 because once I put this on Premiere on YouTube, it takes 2 minutes for the whole thing to start, which gives you time to come in, say hello, ask any questions. I am always going to be in there. So I'd like to make something really clear. This is not like making a video and giving the students a video to take notes. It is not the same. I am here with you. I am in the chat box, typing away, answering questions, interacting with you. You're interacting with me, writing your answers in there, and I read the entire chat log after it's done so I know who was here and who was not, which is completely different from me sitting in front of, I don't know, 20 black screens where people have their microphones muted and I'm there talking while they could be doing anything because I'm just talking away. I ask somebody to turn on their microphone. They say, "Oh, my dog is barking. My sister is vacuuming." Those are the two most common excuses, which are sometimes are actually things are happening, or people turning on music and nothing really getting done. So this works because you're here and you have to pay attention to what's being said so you can answer the questions back to me. So the reason why I use the Premiere rather than just sending a video for you to watch. First of all, I know that a lot of people are not going to watch it. Second of all, I feel like the interaction needs to happen for this to be a real class. And it is a real class. You better believe it. So please make sure that you answer questions, type it in. Even if you're, "Oh no, but what's his face already put in the answer." It's fine because I'm going to look at it and see that you also put it in. There is a delay depending on where you are. So somebody might be typing in the answer at the same time as you, but then their answer comes up first and yours comes up a second later. It doesn't mean that you copied it. It means that there's a delay. So this is a real class. After we're done with this, I'm going to go into the video conference on Skype with you. Might not be fantastic, but I do need to have that as well because that gives you a chance to speak. Those of you who refuse to speak during the video conferences, I can't give you a grade in speaking. How can I give you a grade in speaking if you don't speak? I mean, if you don't speak, how do I know? It makes sense, right? So language. I know that in Norway there are goals and aims for your studies. It's very different from my previous experiences in teaching. But here's the basics: listening, reading, writing, speaking, and thinking. Those are the five abilities I want you to have. I want you to be able to think in English. I want you to be able to write in English. I want you to be able to understand spoken English. I want you to be able to read a text in English and be able to understand it. I want you to be able to use the language effectively. So that's what I'm asking of you. Let's get started. Today we're starting with chapter five. Sorry, chapter four. It's funny because I'm looking at it right there. Chapter four, Citizens. This book has been quite an experience. I know that some of the exercises are a bit difficult, so I've been changing and adjusting some of the exercises for you. And I'm not giving you all of the tasks, I'm giving you some of them to make sure that everyone is accommodated. Chapter four. Chapter four. It's quite an interesting chapter because it brings up some things that we have been talking about off and on in our classes. One of the things that we will be talking about in this chapter is cultural differences. What are some cultural differences that we have observed over the years as people walking on this earth, meeting people from different cultures. I'd like you guys to type in the chat box right now if you have met somebody of a different culture with a different background when it comes to ethnicity, when it comes to language from a different country. Knowing me does not count for this exercise, all right? I'm talking about somebody else other than me. Please, I'm just going to give you a few seconds to do it because I want to make sure that everyone types. If you have never met anybody of a different ethnic background, then put no, I've never met somebody. I'm waiting. I don't know if you're doing this or if you're doing this, if you're on your phone. I really don't do this on my phone. I just use my one thumb. Maybe I'm weird. Type it in. Have you ever met somebody from a different ethnic background with different cultural background from you and different ethnicities? Me, knowing me does not count. Before me or after me. I want you to write a little bit about where this person was from and what was your relationship with them. So I know that you probably don't want to type a long, long thing. So just say, I met a boy from Ghana. We were in the same football team, something like that. Just two sentences, type it in. Or still, if you haven't met anybody, no, Pollyanna, you are it. You're the only person of a different ethnic and cultural background I've ever met, which is fine, but at least you met somebody. It is good to have that diversity in your life where you can see that different people appreciate different things, but we're still people. So I'm gonna count to 10 in my head and see if I can see the answers. Please keep typing. You still have a chance to. I may not be responding to every answer right now, but I will be looking at the chat log to see what your answers were. Well, those of you who have met people of different backgrounds prior to me or after me, you have now an idea that not everything that you do is the same as what this other person does. And from knowing me, you have encountered a few differences already. When I speak Norwegian, I have an accent that some of you might think is funny, some of you might think it's a little cute, some of you might think it's just dreadful. But it's because I learned Norwegian as an adult. So you may have encountered somebody, you may have met somebody who speaks Norwegian with an accent before. And at first, you may be like, why can't this person just speak correctly? We're doing the best that we can, trust me. Some of the sounds in Norwegian may not exist in that person's language. So, for example, I have to make a huge effort to do, it's very difficult. And I know the sounds, but sometimes when I'm saying the words, the sounds don't come up. They don't come up, they don't come out. I try to use words that I can say, but sometimes it's, so I have a lot of respect and empathy with everybody who's learning a language. And I know that one of the people that have been to our classes observing you made an observation about the pronunciation. That some of you may have a very thick Norwegian accent when you speak English. That doesn't bother me, and that is not a problem for anybody. As long as you're able to pronounce the words, and as long as your pronunciation is intelligible, it's perfectly fine by me and by everyone else in the world. Of course, as a teacher, as somebody who has grown up in the States, has studied their entire life. Of course, I want to have the closest to a native speaker pronunciation as possible. It doesn't have to be perfect, but it has to be very intelligible, very clear, and people are supposed to understand me. Whenever I am in different countries, people mistake me for being American all the time. But when I am in America, people are like, "Oh, but you have an accent. Where are you from? I wonder where you're from." But some people, when they don't know where I'm from, they just guess American. It doesn't matter what kind of accent you have. When you move to a different country, all you need to do is learn something about the culture, learn the language, and try to speak it. And I try my hardest with Norwegian. So now, language is one of the cultural differences. Can you tell me other cultural differences that you see in people from different cultures? Without being, please, when you type your answers right now, please do not be, how do I put this, insensitive. In other words, be nice when you write this. Differences that you see. Go. When you meet somebody of a different culture or ethnicity, what are some of the differences that you see? Type it in. I'm giving you a few seconds to type. I'm doing this because I'm assuming everybody's on a computer, but you could be doing this on your phone, or if you type with a one thumb, you could be doing this. This is just me giving you time to answer. I may or may not be interacting with all the answers. I may not be typing to everybody, but I will watch this later to see who typed in. And that is part of your grade. Because in this class, when we do the YouTube version of it, we have listening, writing, and reading. So three of the five abilities are involved here. Perhaps even thinking. The only thing that we can't really have is speaking. Therefore, we need to have a video conference where you can also speak. So I've seen some of the differences that you put in, differences in culture, differences in dress. In some cultures, it is more common for somebody to wear a certain type of clothing depending on their religion, depending on what time of the year it is. And I'm not just talking about, oh, wear a coat because it's winter. I'm talking about more like perhaps in the United States, for example, don't wear white after Labor Day. It's one of those things. It may not be so for everybody, but some people might follow that. There are cultures within the culture, differences within that same culture. We're going to listen right now. I'm going to make sure that you have the right page on the book. We're going to listen and read. Let me see. This text is about cultural differences. And one of the things that I want you to pay attention to I want you to pay attention to a few things. I want you to pay attention to not just what's being said, but I also want you to be paying close attention to how it's being said. You will have some texts read by different people of different ethnicities, of different cultural backgrounds, and you will hear a difference in how they pronounce the words. So those are the pages. We're moving a little bit further into the book. That does not mean that I'm not going to go back and read what we had before. Citizens, page 100, and wait for it, 170 That's where it starts. And it looks like that. Cultural complications. I will be stopping the text and asking questions throughout. Not too much. We'll see how much time we have for our video conference today. I hope everybody's ready. I'm going to play the text and stop in certain parts to ask questions. And you're going to be typing it in.
Cultural complications. In the short story, They Don't Mean It, by Lenzi Namioka, the protagonist, Mary Yang, tells the story of when her Chinese-American family had some American friends over for a Chinese New Year's meal. One of the guests is Mary's friend, Kim. After having eaten the fish and vegetable salad, followed by cookies for dessert, the guests are about to leave.
Since it was a weekday night, people didn't stay long after the last cookie was eaten. There was congestion at the front door as the guests thanked us for inviting them and showing them what a real Chinese New Year dinner was like. The fish was delicious, Mrs. Eng said to Father. I'll have to get the recipe from your wife one of these days. She's a wonderful cook, isn't she? Oh no, she's not a good cook at all, said Father. You're just being polite. I heard a little gasp from my friend Kim. She stared wide-eyed at my father. What's the matter, Kim? I asked. Instead of answering, Kim turned to look at Mrs. O'Meara, who was saying to my mother, I loved your 10-vegetable salad. Even the kids loved it, and they don't usually eat their vegetables. You and the girls must have spent hours doing all that fine dicing and slicing. The girls did the cutting, and I'm sorry they did such a terrible job, said Mother. I'm embarrassed at how thick those pieces of celery were. I heard another gasp from Kim, who was now staring at Mother. But I didn't get a chance to ask her what the problem was. The O'Meara's were going out the front door, and the rest of the guests followed.
Mary's friend Kim is shocked to hear how Mary's mother and father do not accept the compliments their guests give them, but rather downplay their efforts in putting together the meal. Mary then explains to Kim that in her culture, accepting these compliments would be like bragging, and that it is good manners to contradict people when they compliment your family.
Let's talk about some of what just happened here. Cultural complications. So the first thing that we hear, I want you to type in right now, what kind of culture are they talking about? Country, nationality, just explain it how you see it. What is the social situation that's going on here? A social situation, going to a party, having dinner together, going to the theater together, socializing at the gym. What kind of situation is going on here? I want to see all the answers. Remember, just because somebody's answer shows up right after yours doesn't mean they're copying your answer. There is a delay on YouTube. Please, what kind of social situation were these people involved in? Type it in. What's customary in different cultures? For example, here in Norway, after you eat dinner, you say takk for maten, thank you for the meal. Thank you for the food, if you're going to be literal about it. Right. In some situations, I have seen people who don't know about this. Maybe they even learned how to speak Norwegian before coming to Norway. They learn how to speak Norwegian, but they didn't learn the culture. So they will go to somebody's house and they'll have dinner. After dinner, they're not going to say takk for maten, but they will say something like maten var veldig fin. Det var fantastisk. They will say, oh, the food was so delicious. It was fantastic. But they won't say takk for maten, right? They won't thank you for the food, but they will say how delicious the food was. And that is their way of showing they appreciated the efforts put into the dinner. Guess who did this? I thought that just saying, oh, the food is delicious. Oh, how wonderful. I thought that was my way of appreciating it. I did not know that in Norwegian culture, what is customary and polite to do is to say takk for maten. I did not learn that until a few months after I was here, and I had never said that before. And I heard from somebody at a table where I was sitting, oh, this is the first, they said it in Norwegian, of course. This is the first time that Pollyanna has actually said thank you for the food. And I was like, They probably didn't think I understood it. But all the other times, I appreciated it. And I said, oh, the food's delicious. But I didn't say takk for maten. So it is a cultural thing that can also be interpreted in different ways. If you go to a different culture and you say thank you for the meal, it will sound a little strange. So it is really a matter of perspective. Let's continue to listen to this. I'll stop again and ask more questions.
Intercultural communication. Two major factors increase the risk of people misunderstanding each other: language problems and cultural differences, as in the short story excerpt you have just read. Communication that involves people with different communication styles or ways of thinking is often called intercultural communication. If we want to understand people better, we need to gain knowledge of their background. Of course, it is important to remember that we meet people and not cultures. If you know someone well, it is much easier to communicate with them. In every society, people have their own ways of doing things, but it is not a realistic goal to learn all the details of how things are done everywhere in the world. Instead, we should focus on learning how to discover differences between people more easily. What is culture? We can define culture as the way of life of a group of people. Culture shapes and affects our lifestyles in terms of what food we eat, what clothes we wear, and how we wear them, how we celebrate events like birthdays and weddings, and how we greet visitors. You belong to several cultures, and this forms part of your identity. Even though cultures change over time, the most important values in a culture remain the same. A common culture binds people together and gives them something to be proud of. When we talk about cultures, we often mean national cultures. For instance, the Norwegian or American culture. However, within a national culture, there are also other cultures. They can be based on ethnic group, age, gender, regional identity, sexual identity, profession, or even family. A 16-year-old Norwegian girl from Stavanger may therefore have more in common with a young Irish girl than with a 60-year-old man from Tromsø. Also, a school and a workplace have their own culture, created by the people who are part of that environment. When people with different backgrounds meet, it may help to be aware of some intercultural communication issues. For example, in some Asian societies, silence is an important part of the conversation, as it signals that you are listening carefully. In other societies, silence in a conversation is something negative, which makes the speaker continue speaking to avoid the silent periods. Another cultural difference is the way in which people disagree. In some societies, people find that loud disagreement can be healthy for an open discussion. In others, disagreements are expressed more gently, and the speaker may even say yes when they actually mean no. Differences in body language can also be a cause of confusion. In most societies, nodding your head means yes, while shaking your head means no. However, in some societies, the opposite is the case. The elements of a culture. Each culture consists of a number of elements, some very visible, others more hidden. Elements like food, clothes, the system of government, and typical traditions are easy to notice. However, hidden elements, such as values, attitudes, and unwritten rules for how to behave, may be even more important when it comes to understanding a person's cultural background. After all, these elements are the key to understanding what is considered right and wrong, or good and bad, in a culture or society.
Now I have some questions to ask about that. The first question I'm going to ask is about what's written on page 172. Page 172. What is culture? Please type in the definition of what is culture according to one of the first things that's presented on the text. Type it in. What is culture? How is it perceived? How is it defined according to what we just listened to? Okay, I'm acknowledging the answers in the chat box right now, if there are any. Sometimes when I ask these questions, I don't see a lot of answers, and I want to see answers because I'm going to look at this chat log, and you're graded on everything that you do, on your behavior in class, which also includes the behavior in the chat box here, on how you answer the questions, how you participate, how you try, all of that. The next question is, they talked about culture and then they talked about national culture. Please type in how you perceive what national culture is. What does national stand for? I know that the word national sounds very much like national, which is, you know, in our region, in English, when those words are so similar and they mean the same, isn't it amazing? Isn't it? Because then you don't need to think too much. But be careful, because those cognates, a cognate is a word that really looks and even sounds like a word in another language. Sometimes it is a false cognate because it may sound and look like that and it might mean something completely different. My next question to you is, I'm going to ask this question of you right now. The elements of a culture. I want you to give me two examples of elements of a culture. Type it in. You can take them straight from the text. Some of you may have said, well, the text has, I think, three or four, but I asked you for two, and I'm pretty sure food and clothes probably came in straight away because those are very, I want to say obvious, but it's not exactly obvious, but it's more visible and more noticeable. Now we're going to power through the rest of this text, And after that, we're going to go into our video conference.
Christopher, a Norwegian exchange student in England, recounts his first visit to the home of one of his friends.
When Timothy's mum opened the door, I extended my hand for a polite handshake, while she moved one step closer and went in for a hug. I ended up giving her a slight punch in the stomach as a first impression. In the hallway, I started taking off my shoes, but that was the second error. "Keep them on," Timothy's mum insisted. After a while, Timothy's mum asked if I'd be staying for tea. I answered, "Yes, thank you," thinking that a cup of tea would be nice. But when we entered the kitchen, I understood that tea was just another word for dinner or supper. After the meal, to show that I did have some manners, I said to Timothy's mum, "Thanks for the meal." She seemed a bit surprised at this, and it was only later that I discovered that "takk for maten" is a typically Norwegian thing to say, which doesn't quite translate to English.
Hoda works the till in a bakery in a Norwegian city and ran into some problems after having been to a wedding.
In my family, all women get henna decorations on their hands and feet as wedding preparations. And as I returned to work on Monday, the paint was still visibly decorating my hands. When my boss saw this, she said that the painting looked unhygienic and told me to wash it off. I explained that the decorations can't be washed off, but they will wear off in 1 to 3 weeks. My boss then said that since my hands looked dirty, I would have to wear protective gloves all day while working the till until the henna decorations were gone. She said that the customers would not want to buy any baked goods from me, even though I use food tongs and never touch the food with my bare hands.
Growing up within a society, it is easy to assume that the rest of the world thinks and behaves the same way as we do. However, as Christopher and Hoda experienced, new situations can present many challenges. When we are in contact with other societies, we discover that they may have ways of seeing the world that are different from our own. The sense of space and time. Within a society, there is generally a feeling of what is acceptable and what is not. One example of an unwritten rule for how to behave is the general sense of space in a society. Have you noticed how people are seated on trains and buses in Norway? Normally, Norwegian people who do not know each other will choose to sit apart. In other societies, for instance in Portugal, you might find that people in general will choose to sit much closer to each other. In Norway, most people would show up no later than 7:15 p.m. for a 7 o'clock appointment, although it makes a difference whether the appointment is a party or a meeting. In another society, it could be perfectly all right to show up at 8 p.m. for a 7 o'clock appointment. The sense of how late is too late is just different from place to place and situation to situation.
All right, everyone, here's what's going to happen now. I'm going to ask a couple of questions about what we just talked about here. And I want you to observe the girl with the decorations on her hands. I want you to tell me in a couple of sentences, type in a chat box, why she had that and why was it not acceptable? Why did she have the decorations in her hands? You can even see a picture of it. If you look, there we go. She has some hand decorations there. Why did she have the decorations and why were they not acceptable? What was the problem? In what situation did that pose a problem for her? Please type it in. I'll be looking at the answers, and even if somebody types in the answer before you, it doesn't necessarily mean that they answered it before you. It might just be that because of the delay, yours came in after. Next and last question. When they talked about sense of space for Norwegians in your culture, maybe this is now more so because of the COVID-19 limitations, that people are sitting in a certain way on the bus or on the train. But what do they describe here? How do they describe how people will sit? Who will they sit with? Again, those are just perceptions that people will see culture as a whole, but it might not be every single Norwegian person that behaves in that way. That's what we're going to be discussing in our video conference. I'm going to leave the link for you in the chat box. And we will be discussing in our video conference cultural stereotypes, or stereotypes, depending on how you want to pronounce it, and prejudice. Those are the two things we're going to be discussing. I will have some of you read out loud. So I deeply appreciate when people read out loud, when people answer questions out loud. I can't force you to do it, but I can say this. When you don't say anything, it's like you're adding a zero to your grade, because I can't give you a grade in speaking if you don't speak. So you have to say something. So it would be really helpful if everybody could speak. So I'm going to have everybody read something. And that video conference will be on Skype. It'll be starting as soon as everybody's in there. I'll be waiting. I'm just playing songs about waiting.
oceans apart, day after day, and I slowly go insane. I hear your voice on the line, but it doesn't stop the pain. If I see you next to never, how can we say forever? Wherever you go, whatever you do, I'm gonna be right here waiting for you. Whatever it takes, or how my heart breaks, I will be right here waiting for you. I took for granted all the times that I thought would last.